Bulvanaka, and welcome Fiji to Speak Your Mind. I'm your host, Dion Thavu, and today we'll be talking about something very important, something of, yes, national importance, I should say. And this is, of course, fire safety and being more aware of the fire hazards in and around your home, your business, and, of course, wherever it is you do your work. And with us today in studio, we have Mr. Timothy Nakaruru, who is the Divisional Officer, Fire Safety, for the National Fire Authority of Fiji. Pulivinaka, Mr. Nakaruru, and welcome to Speak Your Mind. Thank you very much for taking the time out to be here with us.
Thank you, Pulivinaka, Dion. Thank you, FPC. Really glad to be here to speak on this subject of fire safety.
And yes, before we get into the questions, Mr. Nakaruru, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, thank you. I started with the fire service 17 years ago in year 2000, began as a probationary firefighter. And then with more training and more years of experience on the job, and proceeded up to the position I'm in at the moment. I currently look after fire safety for the whole of Fiji. So community education programs, investigation at fires, structural fire safety, compliance of buildings and businesses, as well as the delivery of commercial training. Yeah, throughout. Before that, I was in operations, managing the fire stations at operations level, responding to fires. That's briefly on my history with the National Fire Authority. I'm actually from the island of Kandavu, and I was staying here on Vutilevu.
Thank you for that, Mr. Nakaruru. Of course, ladies and gentlemen, our guest today from the National Fire Authority, the Divisional Officer of Fire Safety, Mr. Timothy Nakaruru. Now, Mr. Nakaruru, with our first question, as an organization, what are the objectives of the National Fire Authority?
We have a vision that is to build community resilience towards emergencies. You will note that it's not only on fires that we hope we have a vision to work on with our communities. It's also to do with other hazards and disasters, like floods and cyclones and tsunamis. Our vision is to build community resilience, and we hope to do that by working together with the communities rather than operating on our own.
I see. And you've already mentioned a few of the emergency situations that the National Fire Authority deals with, but going a little bit further in depth, what are some of the other emergency situations that officers of the National Fire Authority deals with, apart from house fires?
Apart from house fires, we do attend to motor vehicle accidents on the road, industrial accidents, like if there are any collapses or people are stuck in, like fallen structures. We do respond to swift water rescue during floods, even rescue of animals and pets. We also do respond to any spillage in hazardous materials that need to be contained or taken care of. That's part of our response capabilities in that area. We also respond to calls for help during disasters, cyclones, even for tsunamis. We are on standby in the area of response, as directed by the National Disaster Management Office. Those apart from those response duties that we carry out, we are also responsible for the delivery of fire prevention strategies. Okay, that to do with education of children, adults, and communities, so that fires are prevented. Also, we ensure compliance of buildings with regards to the fire safety requirements of National Building Code. So those are some of the other duties that are on our plate as the National Fire Authority.
So you could say the NFA has a very full plate when it comes to looking into these sort of matters.
Yes, of course. We are in the business of emergency management, and we have to look at all the phases. So we'll have to look at prevention of fires and other emergencies, the preparedness phase, the response phase, as well as the recovery phase. We work hand in hand with the Ministry of Local Government and the Red Cross Social Welfare in the recovery of people or victims of fires. Eh? So you could say we are an emergency management organization.
And Mr. Nakruru, who oversees the National Fire Authority's work? Is there somebody that the National Fire Authority has to report to or to show that this sort of work is being carried out?
Thank you. The National Fire Authority is a statutory body. Okay, we come under the Ministry of Local Government, Housing and Urban Development and Environment under the Honourable Minister, Mr. Pravin Bawa. With a structure, with a board, the board chairman, Commander Francis Keane, and a seven-member board, and then a CEO, who is the head of the organization, who's responsible for the overall management of the organization. Eh? So that's basically our structure. We are a statutory body, government organization.
I see. And moving on with our questions, a lot of people have been curious to find out how many fire stations are there in Fiji at this moment in time.
Hopefully with the two more opening up soon, which we are completed building, we will have a total of 18 fire stations throughout Fiji.
That's 18. And these two more fire stations that are currently being built, currently in progress, where exactly are they?
These are the Sianganga fire station up in the north, and also Taviuni fire station, also up in the...
So these are two brand new fire stations?
Brand new fire stations, government-funded fire stations that are just waiting to be commissioned in the near future, next few weeks.
Well, to our listeners and of course our viewers at home, for you in Sianganga and in Taviuni, you can be expecting two brand new fire stations in the near future, courtesy of our friends at the National Fire Authority. Of course, today in studio with us, Mr. Timothy Nakruru, the Divisional Officer, Fire Safety of the National Fire Authority. Bulumanaka Fiji, and welcome back to Speak Your Mind. I'm your host, Dion Davu, here with us in studio today from the National Fire Authority, Mr. Timothy Nakruru, who is the Divisional Officer Fire Safety. In our first segment, we touched a little bit on exactly what the National Fire Authority does, what exactly the services they offer, and of course, who oversees their work, and also the addition of two new fire stations in Sianganga and Taviuni. And continuing with our questions, Mr. Nakruru, does the National Fire Authority feel that we as a nation have adequate resources, meaning fire stations, the equipment, the manpower, to cater for our ever-growing population here in Fiji?
Thanks for that question. You know, as a firefighter, we'll always have a never-ending wish list to what we want to have, to be able to have a quality response to the communities. But at the moment, the support we've had from Gabon with these two new stations coming up, state-of-the-art stations, two just opened lately towards the end of last year, and we have some international standard vehicles that are now with us, ladder appliances, turntable appliances. These are some of the resources we never had before. And currently, at the moment, we are running a recruit of another 35 more for firefighters. So when you have that, when you ask that question about adequate resources, we are glad that the government intention is to upgrade our resources. And the way we are going now, I'm really excited about what we can offer to the communities of Fiji, with the expansion in stations, the acquisitions of new trucks and state-of-the-art trucks. These are Scanias that are equivalent to international standard fire trucks, the ones that you see in Australia and New Zealand. And also with the regular recruits that we are having, this is something that we've never had before over my 17 years of service.
So that leads us to our next question. There are indeed plans or directives in place to ensure that the NFA has the resources that it needs?
Yes, we put together documents such as strategic plans. We're working on a strategic framework that's a five-year document that ends in 2018. That's next year. That's what we are planning for. But the whole thing, intent of our planning is that we move along with development. Okay, as our towns and cities and settlements develop, we, as the fire and emergency service, we need to develop and move along and upskill ourselves and upgrade our resources to the development stand that's going on, as well as what the environment is posing to us, eh? Climate change and all the trends in the weather patterns, eh? Climate patterns. So we need to monitor all this and grow together with the changing environment that we are facing, eh? The types of emergencies.
So it'd be safe to say that the NFA, as our population grows, the NFA would certainly be growing along with it.
Certainly, not only with the number, but also we are concerned with the shift in population, the drift.
These are people moving from rural to urban centers.
Urban centers. That's where we expect that more incidents will happen around where people move to and where the density of population begins to increase.
Is this something that the NFA notices, or maybe this would be true for the rest of the world as well? Wherever the population density increases, of course, there would be more fires. Would I be safe in saying that?
Yes. One of our very senior fire officers in the past, he always says that there are only three main causes of fire, and these are the men, women, and children.
I see. Out of all the point to that.
So wherever there is a concentration of population, there is an expectation generally that fires or incidents of emergencies will increase. Yeah?
And of course, with us today on Speak Your Mind, Mr. Timothy Nakaruru, who is the Divisional Officer for Fire Safety of the National Fire Authority. Once again, Mr. Nakaruru, thanks for taking the time out to be here with us on the show. And continuing with our questions, how often do National Fire Authority firefighters undergo training?
Yeah, apart from the required ones that you're required to undergo to maintain your sort of your competency levels, each firefighter, when coming on shift, will be required to complete 2 hours of solid practical drills every day. So the training of a firefighter, it's an ongoing thing. Eh? It never stops, eh? Because we wouldn't want to have laxity creeping into our firefighters. We had to keep them sharp with their skills and knowledge at all times, eh? Physically, mentally, and also spiritually.
When you say there's a list of certain criteria that they have to meet, and you talk about being physically fit, mentally fit, and of course, do they have certain trainings for this, or this is just given to the firefighters to make sure? Maybe I should rephrase that.
Yeah.
When you say mentally and physically fit, of course, that the National Fire Authority recruits and officers and training, they have to maintain a level of fitness.
Yes.
When it comes to physical fitness. Mm. What about mental fitness? Are they given out any tests or the like?
That's a good question. When you say mentally, it's a broad thing, because as we were talking about earlier on, we undergo some very emotional situations. Eh? So once said that firefighters are people with questionable mentality.
Yes, you guys do run into burning buildings and everybody runs out.
But they have to carry out tests, eh? Initially when entry level, and at every stage, at refresher courses, they have to sit tests and pass those tests. Otherwise, they would not proceed to the next level. Eh? So that takes care of the knowledge bit of things.
Very interesting. Mm. And in regards to the training, who exactly carries out the training for NFA, National Fire Authority officers?
We have a local training department. We have a training department with very capable training officers. And then we are thankful to JICA and also to AFAC of Australia for providing training opportunities for us, for our firefighters to go over to Japan for certain specialized training. And also we have an arrangement with the Australasian Fire Authorities commission where some of our firefighters go over for training, or trainers come across to deliver training for us. Eh? And then we have the Institute of Fire Engineers, which some of our members, our firefighters, join and upskill themselves through distance learning, eh? And qualifications through the fire engineering field. Eh? Yeah, those are some of the avenues which I can think about that that we rely upon to provide training for our firefighters. Eh?
And just before we head to our break, what level are we here in Fiji compared to the rest of the world?
Well, our chief fire officer, former chief fire officer, who was an Australian gentleman, he once said to us that, you know, he, having seen firefighting in Australia, in Victoria, and seen the way we do our firefighting, he said, he always says that Fijians are the best firefighters in the world. And I never would forget that comment. Eh? And I would say the level that we are at, probably we can compare ourselves to the rest of the world, eh? Just like in rugby or in anything else. Our firefighters are quite capable, and I think it's because of the passion and the compassion that's within them. Eh? That's with the islanders, eh? As the islanders that you know, drives them to be the best in the world. Eh? They can be the best in the world, provided if we put them through more training, more exposure. Yeah, they can even surpass some of the best in firefighters in the world. Eh?
So we in Fiji, even though we are a smaller country, of course we are a smaller nation, and we have less resources than compared to the other larger nations on earth, we still have a fairly competent, a fairly good firefighting service, that'd be safe to say.
Yes, it's firefighting, if you understand it, if you come to join the firefighting brigade, you'll find it's more of a teamwork thing than an individual. That's what we are good at. In the Fiji Fire Service.
Well, thank you for that. Our guest today, Mr. Timothy Nakaruru of the National Fire Authority. We'll have more after the break. Bulvinaka, and welcome back to Gold FM's Speak Your Mind. I'm your host, Dion Davu, and today in studio with us, from the National Fire Authority, the Divisional Officer Fire Safety, Mr. Timothy Nakaruru. Mr. Nakaruru, once again, thank you for being with us on the show. Continuing from where we left off, can you briefly describe the day-to-day activities of a firefighter when not attending to an emergency situation?
Okay, in those days, on those shifts where we are not really busy with call-outs, most of the time is placed on preparedness, that is the proper checking of equipment and all gear. We ensure that they are all well serviced. What needs to be replaced is replaced, and what needs to be repaired is repaired. And then the firefighters have to undergo the required training, 2 hours training, to maintain their level of competency, as well as they would be sent out normally to communities to do community awareness education programs. Yeah? Sometimes we have schools or communities visiting the stations, and we put out a program for them. Eh? Apart from attending to fires or when waiting for the call, we normally involve ourselves in preparedness and prevention activities. Yeah? And mostly to do with our fire education and delivering fire safety programs. Eh? At other times as well, you'd find our trucks going out and checking, testing fire hydrants, cleaning the areas around them. Those are some of the duties that we attend to when not responding to fires. Eh?
And moving on, if you will, can you paint for us a picture? What are some of the dangers that a firefighter has to deal with during an emergency situation? Because this, I would think, a lot of people, they don't realize the danger involved, apart from fire, when a firefighter does tend to an emergency situation. So please, can you just briefly describe for us what are some of the dangers that a firefighter can face during an emergency situation?
Yes, we all know that, you know, fire is a dangerous element, but even en route to a call, if it's a false alarm or just a hoax call, that urgency to get there, it presents danger to the firefighters, on the riding on the fire appliances. And then once arriving at the scene, then the products of fire, such as smoke, falling debris, collapsed roofing, and all that, those are some of the dangers we face. And that's to do with firefighting on fires itself. But on other rescues, when we go to contact rescues, there's always danger in the area that's affected. There's danger in the motor vehicle setting alight and probably causing an explosion. There's a danger in it, being unstable and then falling on somebody's hand or foot while they're trying to work under the vehicle. There's always danger in dealing with emergency situations, and that's why they have to undergo very comprehensive training, and the officers in charge have to have a safety-minded approach. Always have a safe approach when attending or responding to emergencies.
When you talk about having a safety-minded approach, I think that's something that something that all of us should work towards. A safety-minded approach in all things, in all facets of
that's
our
right,
life.
Yeah, that's right, Dion. I think we, the Fijians, we have somehow we're too quick to jump into situations without realizing or making a quick assessment of the risk and dangers involved.
That's true, yes, very true, Mr.
And sometimes we are so relaxed and carefree that we have that attitude that it never would affect me. You know, it's not that dangerous, you know, until you are really affected. Your house burns down or your vehicle gets involved in an accident. Then you take the dangers seriously.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, of course, to our listeners locked in right now on Gold FM, there's a approach. That's an approach to have to everyday life. Have a safety-minded approach, and of course, should you find yourself in an emergency situation and you have a safety-minded approach, I reckon you'll be able to deal with that situation with that safety-minded approach. Mm. Now, continuing with our questions. Firefighters, in the course of carrying out their duties, come across some very mentally disturbing events. Do NFA personnel have regular counselling?
Yes, we have a couple of forms of counselling. One of them is just a peer group counselling. It's a method where, after returning from an incident where there may be fatalities, when we come back, it's always good to sit around and just talk about it. That's the peer group counseling. Talk about it so that it comes out of you and it's not kept inside your head and it affects you. And also we have professional counselors which we can call upon. They come in and talk to the individuals, those who've been involved directly in a situation, especially if there has been nasty accidents where multiple fatalities or is a site of gross injuries and maybe limbs falling everywhere and burn victims at fires. We normally call for professional counseling to talk to the firefighters, just to make sure that that event doesn't affect them emotionally and make them vulnerable to emotional instability.
Thank you for that. Ladies and gentlemen, and of course to our listeners on Gold FM, the Divisional Officer of Fire Safety for the National Fire Authority, Mr. Timothy Nakururu, will have more after the break. Bulvinaka, and welcome back to Gold FM's Speak Your Mind. I'm your host, Dion Davu, and with us in studio today from the National Fire Authority, their Divisional Officer Fire Safety, Mr. Timothy Nakururu. Mr. Nakururu, Continuing with our line of questions that we have here, what happens when an emergency call comes through to a fire station? Can you just describe for our listeners and, of course, our viewers at home?
Okay, when we receive an emergency call, it's normally received at our control room. Right? So SUVA has got its own control room looking after the central division. And there's a control room at Lautoka looking after the west and one in Lambasa. Okay, your call would be directed to any of these control rooms. Now, once the control room receives that call, they will dispatch that call to the station that's nearest to your address of call. Okay? And when they dispatch that call through, now the stations, the crews are required to respond within 90 seconds of receiving that call. So
that would be the average response time.
That is
90 seconds.
That is like the maximum allowed time. Eh?
That's for the fire crews,
yes,
in the station itself.
Must not be longer than 90
get
seconds.
Get ready and roll out.
Okay, get ready, get out of bed, whatever you're doing, get in your fire tunics, get in your truck and roll out. Okay, and that time is normally taken at the control room as well. Eh? Okay. Now, I know that this is an interesting question because a lot of our viewers or listeners here today are members of the public. They have the perception that, oh, they're taking their time to get up and get in the, they're too busy drinking grog or something. No, the main reason for late response is the delay in receiving that call. We understand that a person in an emergency situation will not be thinking correctly. And in most times, they would forget about the emergency number altogether, okay, or get numbers mixed up. So they go run around, do this, shout for help, get people out, try to put the fire out. And then finally, they think, okay, let's call the fire brigade. Okay, and at times, they call and they call a wrong number. Okay, for information of our listeners, it's wise to remember these numbers: 911, 910, 911, and 912. Okay, either one of these, you'll get right through to our.
So those numbers control. Again: 911,
910, 911, and 912.
Those are the three numbers that you can choose.
If you are on Vodafone, you'd call 910. If you're on Digicel, you'd call 912, and 911 if you're on the landline. But either one of those, if you call it on other networks, you'll surely get through to our stations. Now, I want our listeners to understand this fact. Based on research, it takes approximately 7 minutes for a fire to start and completely engulf.
Only 7 minutes?
Only 7 minutes. That's an average on research. Okay, 7 minutes. So that's the little time that you got, no? From when the fire starts to when it totally engulfs the whole house, okay? And with the buildings, our residential structures we have now, we have smaller houses, more congested, more fire load, eh? Means more things unlike as compared to overseas, they have times in the year where they take everything out and give it away to the charity organizations and all, just keep the house clear. Whereas for us, you'll find in most of our houses, there's quite a lot of stuff in it. Those are all good fuels for fires. That 7 minutes in Fiji, I think it would be much lower, could be about 3 to 5 minutes before the whole.
Due to the fact that there's so many things in houses to catch fire.
Yes.
And moving on. This is something which I've noticed myself in the past, that the NFA has had a lot of prank calls. We've seen it in the papers and, of course, had statements from the NFA. So how does the NFA deal with prank calls and what can prank callers expect if they are caught?
Okay, with your first question, all prank calls that we received, once we've found out the number which they're calling from, we refer this to the police, eh? Refer this to the police, and the police will take it on from there.
See.
So for prank callers, it's a crime.
So it would be a criminal offence to make a prank call
to the
National Fire Authority
National
of Fiji.
And it's a wastage of our resources as well. Some do it for fun, probably having a couple of beers and thought, okay, let's see the response time of the fire brigade. And some are just kids playing with the phones.
Who don't realize.
Yeah, who don't realize. When we find out that they're kids, we just politely tell them, look, put the phone down or give the phone away to your parents. Stop playing with this emergency call line.
Ladies and gentlemen, and of course to our listeners at home, that's Mr. Timothy Nakururu, who's of course the Divisional Officer of Fire Safety for the National Fire Authority. He's just told us that if you make a prank call, it is considered a criminal offence, the police will be involved, and there's a chance that you could end up spending a couple of some time behind bars if found out to be making a prank call to the NFA. Continuing with our questions, Mr. Nakururu, how many structural fires have there been since 2017 began?
Since the year began, we've had 17 fires altogether.
Okay. 17 fires? 17
fires.
And it's only the seventh day of the second month.
Yeah, that's it's quite unusual. It's really unusual, the rate.
It would be around one fire every 3 days or so.
Every 3 days, yeah. There was a couple of 1 or 2 weeks ago where we had 5 fires, one in each day. There was one day where we had 3 fires in a day.
In various locations around the country.
Yes. Yeah.
And these fires, what fires, are they residential fires, business fires, or factories?
Two of those are commercial,
industrial
fires.
Industrial fires.
The rest are residential fires, with people living in the homes and actually in the homes while the fire started.
So the majority of fires that have started this year, they have been in
residential homes, in homes, people's houses.
So which would lead me to believe that people aren't taking care of themselves
while
they're at home.
That's right, normally certain times and seasons in the year, people get careless. Normally around the festive season, preparation to back to school and all that, no? Things are going on in people's lives where they just totally neglect safety. And that's the reason why fires happen in the homes, because people are so busy focusing on other things and forgetting about their safety for themselves and their families.
Thank you for that, Mr. Nakururu. We'll cut to another break, and of course with us in studio, National Fire Authority's Divisional Officer, Fire Safety, Mr. Timothy Nakururu. We'll be back after the break. Bulvinaka, and welcome back to Gold FM's Speak Your Mind. I'm your host, Dion Davu. With us in studio today, the National Fire Authority's Safety Officer, Mr. Timothy Nakururu. Mr. Nakururu, once again, thanks for being with us on the show. And of course, moving on with our questions, how does the National Fire Authority feel about the recent spate of fires happening around the country?
Yes, what we feel and what we're trying to be working on is the targeting our communities. We are thinking really seriously about working towards a very vigorous community education program. Thank you, ABC. This talkback show just comes at the ideal time. I believe that the media could play a very important partner with the National Fire Authority in trying to drill these messages down to our communities. Categories, from the young ones to the old ones. Our people need to learn the devastating effects of fires. Okay, it's not until and unless you've had your property burned down or you've lost someone close to a house fire, then you begin to take fire safety seriously. I believe with the media on our side, we could work towards, really drilling it down to the individual to take safety seriously, let it be a priority in your life, looking after your life, treasuring your life, your property, and the things you've already built up over the years, and looking out for things that could take all those things away. The safety approach that we once alluded to.
Yes, and for our listeners and for our viewers at home, What are some of the most important things to take note of in regards to fire safety at home?
Okay, well, at home, there are a lot of things that can start a fire at home. Eh? One thing that people don't realize is that electricity causes fires. Electrical short circuits, electrical overloads, they can start up a heat and they can ignite and start fires. Okay, so at homes it's important to have a look out on your electrical wiring. You know, have a check. If you are living in an old building or you're renting an old building, get someone qualified, a qualified electrician, to have a look at all the wiring, because the wiring over the years, the insulations get deteriorated, and then the wires get exposed, or probably rodents or rats. Okay, they chew on the insulation, and once those wires are exposed, they can cause an arcing and then short circuit, and they could start a fire in the ceiling areas, the ceiling spaces. These are for older buildings. Okay, as well as if you're buying electrical appliances, go for quality. Don't go for price, eh? Go for quality. Look for the products or electrical appliances that have a standard marking on them, a conformity standard marking on them. These are appliances that have gone through testing processes and they are approved. Okay, they could have a UL standard marking or a CE standard marking. Eh? Look for those that meet a certain test standard. Okay, and buy those. They may be a bit expensive, but go for those ones. You'll be sure they will never catch fire. They will never, start a fire with you. Eh? There are different variety of electrical appliances. Let's say for kettles, things that heat up. Eh? Kettles and irons. Eh? Irons, these are, you have a range to choose from. But look for the one that's been tested and approved. Eh? For electrical appliances. These are for electricity. Okay, if our communities don't realize, electricity can start fires. They can burn your house down. Okay, the second thing is the things that we do each day, cooking. Okay, using matches, you know, for smokers and leaving matches carelessly. You know? These things get in the hands of kids. Kids play with matches because that's their habit. Okay? It's just the adults that leave it carelessly. Okay, and these things start fires and burn houses down. Okay, cooking, kerosene stoves and gas stoves, all these things, prayer deers, you know, candles when lights go out, even mosquito coils. Okay, these things have been known to really destruct or fully destruct a house. Eh? So be careful about the simple things, eh? The things that have heating elements, and the things that have naked flames around your houses. Eh? Okay, yeah, these things, if you're not careful about, they can really ruin your house and even you could lose lives or lives of loved ones. Eh?
We've seen the various National Fire Authority ads, advertisements on television and on radio. There's one there which struck me as quite a good one. This is in regards to the having an evacuation plan for the family. How important is that for families and businesses as well to have an evacuation plan in case of fire?
That's right. In your own home, if it's involved in a fire, in a situation where you wake up suddenly and it's full of smoke, you can lose your way in your own home. That's if you don't have an evacuation plan or emergency evacuation plan. This is something you need to sit together as a family and have discussions about. In every room, there must be the main door in, there must be an alternative exit from every room. And the occupants of that room need to know
what to do.
What to do in case of fire. Because once the house is full of smoke, panic sets in. Okay, and if you don't know what to do, people get killed, they collapse in fires just due to the smoke, from inhaling the smoke. It's not the fire themselves. And some people get lost within their own houses, not knowing where to find exits. Okay, some people live in well-secured houses, always have some sort of engineered burglar grill or bar where you can use as an exit, as an emergency exit. And always have some people lock up, okay, and go up to bed. Always have these spare keys available. And every person in your house need to know where the keys are. And these are very important things to start thinking ahead towards an emergency situation and planning ahead. Okay? And after planning, do practice runs. You know, do some sort of a family fire drill. Okay? These things can help you. Okay? Now that we're having a lot of tsunami alerts, it's also good to do tsunami drills if you live along the coastlines, okay? Or earthquake drills. Yeah?
These are some. This is part of being having a proactive approach.
Yes, this is something our communities need to understand, that emergencies are getting more and more nowadays, okay? And we need to think that way now. From the normal laid-back and relaxed Fiji that we were, now there are more and more incidents of emergencies, and we need to prepare ourselves even mentally, yeah, as a family, all generations, from kids to grandmas and grandpas. Yeah?
Well, that's about all we have time for today, Mr. Nakururu. Nice. Thank you very much for being with us on the show. Of course, this is Gold FM Speak Your Mind. I'm your host, Dion Davu, and our guest today from the National Fire Authority of Fiji, Mr. Timothy Nakururu, the Divisional Officer, Fire Safety. Thank you, sir, for being with us, and of course, we're looking forward to having you in future on the show.
Nakabalevu, Dion, it's my pleasure. Thank you, FBC, for the invitation.
Nakabalevu.